Welcome to Faith That Works, exploring the changed lives of those living by faith. Your host, Bob McHouston, will spotlight ordinary people who have discovered for themselves a faith that works.
Thank you, and we welcome you again to another program, Faith That Works. If you've watched a program before, you know that all we do is talk about the Lord Jesus and how He changes people's lives. He is a life changer without exception. It's impossible to be a Christian without being changed. I don't care if you're 6 years old or 106. If when the risen, resurrected Christ invades an individual's life, I want to tell you, he's going to be different. Maybe to varying degrees, but he's going to be different. Therefore, if anyone be in Christ, he's a brand new person. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are made new. And that's what we talk about here. And it's just regular folks. It's not some kind of superstar. Now, Angie Kemp probably will be a superstar for long with her book. And we've mentioned that book on the program before. Hell's Bend. Hell's Bend. And maybe John can put it on the screen, and if he can't, that's all right. But it's a Barnes & Noble and all over the place. So get that book. Sheila and I are in the process of reading that. She reads to me. We'll have a downtime for an hour or so, and she'll read a couple of chapters out of that book called Hell's Bend. It's a Christian novel. I think that's what it's called. Wouldn't you label that as a Christian novel?
I would.
Christian fiction. Okay, good. So let me encourage you to get Angie, where all could the people pick up that book? Barnes & Noble?
Amazon.com.
Where?
Amazon.com.
Z-Line?
Zulon
Press.
Back of my car.
In the back of Angie's car. If you'll come by the office, we'll probably have a couple of copies here. But get that book. It's just really, really a good book. And what was I talking about? Oh, talking about books. I have a booklet called The New Birth. And we use it as a thank you card to send to people that's watched the program just to say thank you for watching. That's all. And so if you would call the number on the screen, we would, and leave your name and your mailing address. And say it slowly and clearly, because I've sent some booklets out and a couple of them have come back wrong address. So I'm sure I copied it down wrong. But we erase your message. We don't have a mailing list, or we don't keep a record of who's called who. So you just call the number on the screen, leave your name and mailing address, and do us a favor and let us send you this booklet just to say thank you. Will you do that? And I promise you, if you don't get it in a couple of weeks, you call me back and do it again. I know that got a couple of calls from Alabama that I sent the booklet, but it came back and with no address. So I got the address wrong. So if you ordered it and you hadn't gotten it, just call me back again and let me send it to you. All right? And I thank you. We're talking about that new booklet is talking about the new birth and how Jesus changes lives. And we're talking tonight about the same thing, aren't we? Georgia Cruse.
Amen.
I met Georgia 100 years ago.
Amen. Close to it.
And then our friend Joe Adair.
Amen.
And Joe has experienced a service that I'm going to get him to tell us about in a little bit, but just a little bit, Georgia. I don't know how long ago it was I met you in Rankin County Correctional Facility.
Yes.
So you were an inmate there, and right. We were doing a lay renewal, a lay witness mission there.
Yes.
I think that's where I first met you.
It was. Yeah, it had to be somewhere around 1993.
How long had you been locked up at that time? Do you remember?
At that time, I had only been locked up probably for about 3 years.
About 3 years. She's talking to me. My mic's too high. So let me see if just try to get my fat neck out of the way. is that good? If these folks don't tell me what I'm doing wrong, I will never know it. So I just, I may have to hold my shirt down like this, Joe. You've been locked up, what, 2 or 3 years, you say, at that time?
3 years.
Got 3 years.
Yes.
And you have you had a chaplain there that you and I know well.
Yes.
She's retired now, but she's had a real impact.
Yes.
On many, many people's lives, including yours.
Including me, yes.
Georgia, how did you come to know Christ? Was it before you were locked up or after you were locked up?
It was while I was locked up, but it was before I came to the prison. I got saved when I was locked up in jail.
One of those jailhouse conversions that worked.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. One of those jailhouse religions.
Yeah. Well, she just got a jailhouse religion.
Right.
And you've had that for now for how long?
Ooh, since June 30th, 1992.
1992.
Yes, sir.
And it's still real, isn't it?
Still real.
24 years or so.
Yep. Yeah, 24. Yeah. Finna be a birthday coming up soon.
Yeah. Amen.
Next month.
Well, Georgia, tell me a little bit about, sort of catch me up. You were, when you got saved in jail, was that your first time to ever go to jail, or had you been in jail a couple of times before then? Or
I had been in jail.
Tell me a little bit about your growing up, your past, so we can get to know you a little bit.
Okay, I was given away at birth, so I was raised by someone else other than my mother and father. I was raised real strict, and my grandmother raised me, and they went to church 7 days a week. And so, of course, I went to church 7 days a week. But I was going just to be going.
When did you find out that you were given away at birth? Was this later on in life? Or
no, they always told me the
really?
Truth. They always told me.
Okay.
And I knew who my parents were.
Oh, you did?
I just didn't have a relationship with them. But I always went and stayed 1 week out of every summer when I turned 6. My grandmother always told me she wasn't going to let me go stay till I know how to talk and tell the truth. And then she'd let me go so if anything happened, I could tell it.
Oh, I see.
So I would go and stay 1 week out of every year. But my real mother got killed when I was 11 years old. She was 9 months pregnant, getting ready to have a baby. The same day, and her boyfriend shot her with a double-barrel shotgun. Killed her. And so I didn't just really ever see her too much. So I only stayed like 5 summers that 1 week with her. And my father, I seen him a little bit, not much. And so I didn't have a relationship with him either. But as growing up, I loved going to school, and I was real smart and stuff, you know, school-wise and stuff like that. But I used to fight a lot.
No, you didn't.
Oh, my goodness, did I?
Girls don't fight, George.
Well, I did. I used to fight a lot, and I always fought boys. I didn't fight girls. I fought boys. And so I used to fight all the time. And when I was, I started school with immigration. It was real hard. I had to fight. Didn't have a choice.
I understand.
So after I knew I had to, it just came natural then.
Yeah.
Something go on, fight.
Uh-huh.
So I went to school. I loved doing that. When I was about 17, I got raped. I was the starter on the basketball team. I was real good in sports. But at that particular time, if you got pregnant or anything like that, you could not have the baby and still play. So I had to make a decision of whether I wanted to have an abortion or whether to have my baby. Well, I gave up my scholarship, and I had my child. And he's finna be 36 years old.
Wow.
And he's big as ever, praise God, and I thank the Lord for him.
Yeah.
That I did not do that, even though I still didn't know Christ at the time. But I thank God for guiding me.
Yeah.
And then I also, during those years, me and one of my other sisters, there's 19 of us, and one of my other sisters and myself were
19 kids.
19 children, yes, that we know of.
Yeah.
I don't know if you heard that song about Papa was a Rolling Stone. But that was our daddy. Wherever he laid his head, he just was everywhere.
Yeah.
So we got different mothers. Yeah. I mean, and stuff. So it's 19 of us though. And so we had a brother that raped and molested us and stuff like that. So I've been through a whole lot of different dramas growing up as a child.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, back then we worked on sharecroppers, lands and stuff
mm-hmm.
like that.
I did too.
Yeah, so I had to do a lot of things. I started picking cotton and hoeing cotton and doing
mm-hmm.
crops when I was just about 6. I started cooking when I was probably about 5 and a half, 6 years old. I had to cook for like 50 people in our house.
Mm.
And my mother, grandmother, she would take in homeless people and different things, and I still do the same thing today. And she would cook. She taught us how to cook. I would have a chair at the stove, a chair at the sink, and I'd get a big pot, and I'd put it on there, and I'd go get water from the sink and get in the chair and pour water in there because I was little. I couldn't do it, but she showed me what to do.
Uh-huh.
And back then, it's funny how things are now. You can't even get children when they grown to go in the kitchen and do nothing.
Isn't that the truth?
But back then, you knew what you had to do regardless of what age you were, and you done it.
Mm-hmm.
And so I would cook for like 50 people at 6 years old,
mm-hmm.
making homemade biscuits and just whatever.
When next time you gonna cook a meal? Because me and Joe will come by and see you.
Well, I cook one for you. I can do that. And so I did not quit school 3 months before school was out of 12th grade.
Hmm.
And that was to have my baby.
Hmm.
I got out of school and started working, and I met this guy that, that I thought was just everything.
Mm-hmm.
Thought
Mr.
It was everything.
Wright.
Mr. Wright. Mm-hmm. That was him. And couldn't nobody tell me nothing else.
Mm-hmm.
And I think my baby was like 6 months old. Well, we got married and we had 2 more children. And in that book, it tells you that Prince Charming ended up being a frog.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that was kind of like him. The first year and a half was good. Then he started beating me all the time. I used to get beat every day. And I let him beat me because I loved him. And a lot of time when you love people, you will allow them to take advantage of you and do things
mm-hmm.
that's not right.
Mm-hmm.
You know it's not, but you let them do it because you love them. I didn't stop loving them, but I came to my senses. And I decided this, we can't keep doing this.
Hello.
And so I said, now he can't whip me. What am I doing? So one night I just went crazy. Just had a fighting fit. And I whipped him. And
I've heard of a lot of
yeah,
fits, but I ain't
yeah,
ever
I
heard
had
of
a
fighting fit.
And just whipped him and just went on, and I got out of it. But when I got out of it, I had so much damage on the inside from all of the beatings. I had to have surgery because I was bruised up so bad on the inside. And because, I've been getting beat for 15 years.
Mm-hmm.
I stayed in there 16 and a half years. And for 15 years, I was getting beat every day.
Mm-hmm.
When I done this and I couldn't work, well, he wouldn't help me with the children. He said he wasn't going to help nobody where he didn't live. And so he wouldn't help me with our children. He wouldn't help me do anything. And that led me to start trying to do other things that wasn't godly, which I wasn't saved
mm-hmm.
still at the time anyway.
Mm-hmm.
But I started, I have $2 or $3. I'd go in the grocery store and I would buy some macaroni and some bologna and whatever. And I'd take the $2 or $3 and I'd buy some bread or whatever. And I'd take my purse and I'd put 2 or 3 packs of meat over in my purse. And I'd go home and I would cook because I didn't have any food.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't have any money. And he wouldn't help. And I went to the food stamp office. I went to places. They would say, well, you got to wait 30 days. And I said, but my children are crying because they're hungry now. What am I supposed to do for 30 days? But it was like, well, oh, well, we don't know.
Mm-hmm.
So I done things as I thought a mother should do to feed her children. But one thing led to something else, and the next step was I went to the grocery store and I met some guys that I knew, and they were drug dealers. And so they told me they knew how I could make some money. So I started transporting transporting drugs across the Tennessee line in order to just be a decoy.
Yeah.
Went from transporting drugs to selling drugs. Ended up, just make a long story short, being sentenced to 640 years in the Mississippi Department of Corrections.
You were sentenced to 640 years.
640 years.
And you spent how many years?
12.
Something good happened on the way, didn't it?
Something good happened on the way. And I thought that being locked up was going to be the worst thing that ever happened to me. And of course, in a lot of ways, with losing 12 years with my children, they were babies when I left, they were grown when I got back. It was a lot of things in that, because they had to go through a lot, because my ex-husband was on crack. He didn't take care of them. They had to basically raise themselves. And even though I got all of these sisters and brothers and stuff, you know, everybody scattered everywhere, my children had nobody really.
Georgia, when you got sentenced to 640 years, had you just gotten saved in the jail, or was this, did you get saved right after that sentence?
I got saved right after the sentence, right after.
On your way to prison?
On my way to prison. On my way to prison, because actually I didn't think, the charges that they charged me with, I was not guilty of. But the judge, well not the judge, but the police here in Tupelo had already told me that they was gonna get me one way or the other, even if they had to
make
it up.
They knew you was running drugs.
Right. And so they told me they was gonna get me one way or the other, it didn't matter. And they done exactly that. But I didn't think, you know, I trusted in this system we got. And I thought, well, there ain't no way that they can lock me up, because what they got before, I didn't do it. But they found me guilty. I went to trial, they found me guilty, got 640 years.
And you thought that was the worst thing that could happen to you.
And I thought that was the worst thing that could have happened, me being taken away from my children.
What changed that kind of thinking?
Well, when I got into jail, it was a pastor here that his church name is TCD.
Yeah.
Temple
of Compassion
Temple
Deliverance.
Temple of Compassion Deliverance. And he was a pastor at that time. Well, I used to sing in a group myself. He sung in a group. I was a little girl, even a little older.
That wasn't Bishop Parks, was it?
That was Bishop Parks.
Was it really?
But him and his church family would come to the jail and minister to me. And I would cuss them out. I would do some of the most horrible things you ever heard of in your life. And I'd put my music on. I loved Luther Vandross at the time. I'd put cotton in my ears and go turn the shower on and makeup racket and all kind of stuff. And one day I had my headphones on and the cotton in my ears, and I was listening to Luther, and I was up there and I was just rocking and waving my hands on the bed, and I could hear a voice talking to me. And it was saying, cut that thing off. What are you doing? And I was looking all around like that. I said, who's talking to me? I thought it was somebody in there playing with me. Of course, I didn't play that. And so when I figured out it wasn't, I started listening. But I got saved laying right there on that bed with those headphones on, music loud as it could be, cotton in my ears, and it penetrated.
And God talking to you.
It was God. I took the stuff off. I got off my bed. Thank God. And I repented.
Yeah,
I gave my life to God right there.
Amen.
And I thank God for that. Because I was on my way to a burning hell. But
talk
he loved
grace.
Me enough to change me. So I was doing a lot of different things. I was still selling crack in the jail. I was still just messed up. But when he saved me, I flushed it down the commode.
Amen.
I started witnessing to the rest of the girls in the room with me. I just started doing a lot of stuff. So when I went, God had already prepared me for what was coming. He started doing a lot of stuff in me, quick.
Yeah.
I read
the
whole Bible in 33 days.
Wow.
He was doing something in me quick. I needed it in order to stand.
Yeah.
So when I got there, I got put in that little cell, And I stayed in there a year and a half.
At Rankin County?
At Rankin County. Stayed in there a year and a half in lockdown. They had lights like these. My light was out. I couldn't see unless I laid my Bible at the door. And I would read by the light out in the hallway.
Mm-hmm.
I done that every day and every night. Just read. And after I was saved and I was so hungry for the word, mm-hmm. it seemed like I couldn't get enough. And it seemed like it was just jumping off of the page to mm-hmm. me. I'd be like, wow, this what this means? And it was so clear. Everything was so different. It was like I had been put in a whole new world.
You were. Absolutely, you were.
Everything was different.
Yeah.
And I was just, I don't know. I got out of lockdown and I started working on the canteen, and I didn't work that long, and I knew that wasn't going to be for me because I was going to get in trouble. God instantly sent me Wendy Hatcher
mm-hmm.
to ask me if I wanted to work at the chaplain department.
And she was a chaplain at the time.
She was a chaplain at the time. And that little woman there, man, she made such an impact on my life because she don't play with you.
Mm-hmm.
If you're not right, you're going to know you're not right.
She's going to let you know it, too.
She going to know it. Standing 4'2", she going to let you know. If your attitude bad, she going to tell you your attitude stank and you need to fix it. I remember I was telling Joe this testimony that I went to work one day and I had a bad attitude. I went in, I wouldn't speak. Darling, you know, one of them old thinking you're better than somebody else. Went in my office and closed the door. And she came in there, hey, baby. And I said, good morning, Mom. And she came on in. What's going on? I said, nothing. And, you know, I was trying to talk real, you know.
Mm-hmm.
She said, well, you get your stuff, honey, and put it back in the bag and go to the building, and don't you come back out till I tell you to. And I was like, what? What for what? And she said, well, you'll know later. Just get your stuff, baby, and go on back. I'll come over there. And so when I got there, you know, my attitude was still bad, and I was mad because I know, you know, well, she going to let me come back on all this work over here and all this stuff. She going to let me come back. You know, I had that kind of attitude.
Mm-hmm.
She was going to need me to come back. Well, she didn't need me to come back. She came to see me, and she would say, you ready to come back? And I said, yes, ma'am. And she'd look at me. Real funny, you know, them little eyes looking over them glasses. No, you ain't ready yet. And I say, but Ma, yes, I am. And I was talking to her about it about a month ago, and I told her, I said, do you remember that? And I was telling her. But the reality was, I was ready to go back. But I was ready to go back because I was able to eat free world food. I was able to do different things that you couldn't do over there.
Mm-hmm.
But it wasn't a sorrowful repentance.
Right.
And she knew it.
You're ready to go back because it was better over there.
It was
where you
better
were.
Over there.
Yeah.
But then God dealt with me, and I had to get on my face and repent.
Mm-hmm.
And when I did, she knew it.
Mm-hmm.
She came and told me, come on. You come on back now. But I never let my attitude get out of place no more. And I deal with my flock the same way now.
Your flock. What do you mean your flock?
Well, I am now the pastor and the bishop of Trinity Faith Deliverance Church. That's located at 1594 Gun Club Road. Last year in January, I met a man named Pastor Ray Ware. He had never seen me, I'd never seen him, but he said the Lord told him to pray about me, and he was retiring, but he blessed me and gave me his church.
Mm.
And I thank God for that. It's not a big, big church, but it's like a cathedral to me.
Yeah,
and I love it, and so.
is this the church, Joe, that you went to? And
we met together. This fellow Mook, a homeless fellow that I was kind of helping out, and she was too at the same time. He would call one or the other. We ended up meeting. Actually, Mook invited me to her church service one Sunday morning, and that's when I went there. Around January.
I think we've got about 3 minutes left.
I guess I'll tell you about the service. But anyway, the music service was awesome. I did just a piano, the drums, and you know a few vocals. But anyway, the experience I had not just with that, but with Bishop when she was preaching, I mean, she doesn't compromise. And I mean, you can tell that in her life that she doesn't compromise. She didn't care whose feelings she hurt. And I'll just tell you real quick what had happened. Her grandson was sitting next to me. She's up there preaching, and he's sitting there. He fell asleep on that pew. And during her preaching, she walks up and smacked him on the leg. And she said, "Wake up, boy." And he woke up. And she said, "And sit up straight." And she looked around and said, "Anybody else out there sleeping?" And she went on preaching. But she, no compromise. And I love it. And she said she wonders sometimes if she's too hard. Now I'm like, no, that from what I experience with her, is that there's no compromise. And that's the word of God. There's no compromise. But it's an awesome service. And I mean, if you haven't been to her service, that, I mean, I don't want to say you haven't been to church, but you're missing out if you haven't been. That was a blessing for me, a real experience. I've gotten an eye-opener. It's really nice. Bishop George, you know, the ministry she's in
Amen.
Now.
So
ministry.
You had church that day too, huh?
Yes, it was awesome.
It's a little bit different being in a church where the Holy Spirit is moving than just being in church.
Yes.
I wrote something the other day. Tupelo is full of nice churches with nice people doing some nice things, but missing out on the gospel, on fulfilling the Great Commission.
Yes.
And I don't want to spend the rest of my life in just another church with just some nice people doing some nice things and being comfortable doing those nice things.
Yes, God.
But you talk to those people about going to the streets and talking to them about talking to somebody about Jesus. Well, I'm not comfortable doing that. Where does the scripture say do what's comfortable?
I hadn't seen
Amen.
It.
Amen. It's not there.
It's not there, is it, Georgia?
It's not there.
Well, don't you ever let those folks get comfortable in your church.
I won't.
You keep stirring and stirring and stirring. Where's Gun Club Road?
It's out off of West Jackson. When you go through the deep curve, it's the first right as soon as you pass Franklin Collection Agency.
Oh, yeah, okay. I know about where you're talking about. I know where you are.
You pass some pretty houses. Come on down there. It's right on the right. It's on the right.
And what are you in just an interdenominational church? Are you part of a
I am part of a FOIC, which my bishop is Bishop Ronald Cruder for Jackson, Mississippi. But I'm non-denominational.
Yeah.
I just believe in Jesus and Jesus alone.
Jesus plus anything, is it?
No.
Jesus
and Jesus alone. I don't think he need our help. He just want to use us.
He wants to love on us.
Yes.
And use us.
Yes.
And display his love to us and through us.
And through us.
And that's what he wants. Am I about out of time? Or do I have 5 more minutes? I have 5 seconds or 5 minutes? 5 minutes. Oh, I'm going out. Folks, listen. Jesus loves you. Give him your life.